Gentlemen, time has come when we have to unshackle that. First unshackling was done by Narasimha Rao. Second unshackling we have to do right now. If they come into the category of first, that shining India which was there, which is also there, ladies and gentlemen, you can imagine where our country is going to be. With my 52 years of working experience, today I am finding a very strange situation. Share market is down. Property is down in India. Commodities are down. Oil is down. Metals are down. Precious metals are down. People like you and anybody who wants to invest money, they are scared today where to invest money. They don't know where to go. Today I am going to talk about the way forward. Where we have to go. We have no choice but to unshackle our Bharat. They are the future of this country now. The nation has to look after them. I can only say, everybody of you, most of you has invested in the real estate in India in the last few years. Today it's a sorry state. We have a condition where there are 7 million houses, 2.5 million are unsold, 4.5 million are sold, but people who own them are not going to live in them, and people who want to live in them cannot afford them. They have an average price of 1 crore per house. Can you imagine the inventory? And this is not the story in India, this is throughout the world as on today. There are 5 crore houses needed by this country even today. Quality ones. Demand is 40% economically weaker sections. This demand is in the villages, small towns, small, medium, big cities. 30% LIG, low income group. This is also in villages, towns, small, medium, big cities. And MIG, middle income group. This demand is not there in the villages in an organized way, because anybody who's of that level, he builds his own house. But it's there in towns, small, medium, big cities. This 5 crore houses are our challenge of today. All the scene we are seeing here is because property prices appreciated very fast. Here you have an opportunity where the land price is close to 10 lakhs rupees per acre. 250 rupees per square meter. That's where appreciation will take place. You are sitting here. The land price is only 5 lakh rupees per square meter. If you go to the Lutyens, Delhi, it becomes 20 lakhs rupees per square meter. And there are areas in India where land varies from 5 to 10, 20 lakhs rupees per acre. Same pathar and matti. But so, the point is, we have to go there and bring a kind of a development. Hard, difficult, but you have no choice. I would say the areas where we have to now work, A, solar energy. Plenty of sunshine. 15 years back, the cost of installation of a solar power plant was $3 to $4 million per megawatt. Today it has come below $1 million. There is more scope of reduction which will happen. We need it, because maintenance cost will be some, but operation cost is zero. It's free energy. We need people in the construction of houses for these people, because construction industry gives a dynamism to that part. Now coming to the farmers, small and marginal farmers, we cannot increase their income. We cannot increase their land holdings. But we can certainly increase their income by bringing technology and giving financial input. Now, technology means from the same area, they can go for protected cultivation of vegetables, fruits, flowers, oil seeds, which we are importing, pulses. Their income can go up by greenhouse farming 3 to 4 times. If their income increases, the petty trader around them also gets increased. Similarly, unshackling of all artisans also. This is the challenge in front of us. They are looking for. And the time is very ripe because mobile phone has reached everywhere in India. So we can communicate with these people. And second part is Jan Dhan Yojana, which was started there. Everybody has a bank account today. So money can reach them also. But the point is, we have to ensure that they have to be trained. Another area which is there, very promising, our education system has been a mess. We produce people who are unemployable. We need skill development. That has to be another priority. And here I am telling you, is a big opportunity for you also. America is aging. Aging society, very few young people to service them. So is Western Europe. So is Japan, Korea, China also now included in that because of one child norm. So is Australia, New Zealand. I had got a study done through the Planning Commission about 12 years back. 60 million people are required to service these people. In these countries, aging is a problem. The old age, they are totally bored. They have nobody to talk to them also. You give them all facilities, but they are not people to serve them. This is an area where skill development, technical skills, soft skills, personality development, and language skills. When you talk about soft skills, personality development means their mannerism and body language should also be excellent, where they can put comfortable otherwise. India has been a country of respect and earning respect. And this is the time where in skill development, export of manpower is going to be a big challenge for us and it's a huge market. I'll add to that, whatever quality we produce for the export, if somebody can't go abroad, at least the quality of skill development people in India will improve a lot. These are the few areas I have said it. There is oil production. Even after 60 years, 7 years of independence, we are importing 80% of our oil requirement. Fortunately, market is down, so we are not facing crisis. But the fact is, why we have not become self-sufficient in the energy sector? Coal we are frowning upon because of the pollution. Swachh Bharat is a slogan just given recently. And let me show you, the biggest change has been in the last 1 year. Our young children have become conscious of cleanliness. Otherwise, I would say 2 years back, India was a filthy country, although my country also. Now India is a dirty country. From filth, we have graduated to dirty. From dirty, we have to become a clean country. That's our challenge. And this can happen. And can happen only when instead of dumping the waste, we convert waste into an energy, which process has started. This is another opportunity. So having said all this, I would say very clearly, there are opportunities. You look at anywhere today in the globe, China, I had been there, are coming down. They are downhill. America stands still. Canada with large resources, nothing to fear. Western European collapsing. Many countries, few are left like Germany. They'll be solid. Japan has been stagnant for the last 25 years. Korea is going to stay stagnant. Australia will certainly with very vast resources will grow but not that speed. New Zealand is comfortable, again, with small population. Ladies and gentlemen, India is the only beacon of light in the whole universe. Why people talk about India, India, India? Despite all the shortcomings, India offers an opportunity to lift its 800 million people up. And the kind of a economy which we will generate is going to be huge. And that's where we stand today. Our capital growth can be also, GDP growth can also go beyond 15 to 20% if agriculture sector is going to be taken care of. I will take some question and answer at the open house afterwards. And I'm sure you will give a serious thought to it, and God willing, your nation has made you proud in the last 20 years. Before that, there was a time, we Indians, whenever we went abroad, we were considered as trade union leaders of beggar countries. That was what the non-aligned movement was referred in Western world. Today, they look at us with respect and dignity. But this has to be enhanced, not only by you, but by all of us, by making a strong base in India, where nation is about to be resurgent again, and let us do it together. All the best. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much indeed, sir, for that most wonderful keynote address. And ladies and gentlemen, before we proceed further, we acknowledge the presence and welcome on the dais Dr. Shakeel Uzzaman Ansari, who is Member National Commission for Backward Classes, and Sardar Joginder Singh, former Director CBI. Please put your hands together to welcome them on the dais. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a privilege and honor to have Dr. Bhishma Rayan Singh as the Honorable Chief Guest today. Dr. Bhishma Rayan Singh is a devoted Gandhian and a sagacious political leader. He's been the former Union Minister of Parliamentary Affairs, Food and Civil Supplies, Works and Housing and Labour, and was also... So it's my privilege to introduce you. Let me do it, sir. Was the Governor of Assam, Meghalaya, Sikkim, Arunachal Pradesh, Pondicherry, Tamil Nadu, and Andaman and Nicobar. Presently, he is President of the Society, a moving spirit behind it, and the guiding force for the welfare of NRIs. A man with credibility and stability is always a source of strength for the organizational activities. He is associated with the society since its inception, and his views are taken very seriously by the concerned authorities. Dr. Bhishma Rayan Singh Ji, in April 2009, was conferred with the highest award of honor, Order of Friendship of the Russian Federation. It's a privilege to have him amongst us on the dais, as he is one of the few leaders of the country who have been serving the country since the pre-independence era. And ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together to welcome our Honorable Chief Guest for the inaugural address.
My esteemed colleague, according to seniority, chalein to theek rahe. Sardar Joginder Singh Ji, Major Ved Prakash Ji, Ansari Ji, then Secretary General Gurinder Singh Ji, and Dalbir Singh Ji, my dear awardees, ladies and gentlemen, I know that the new year has become 25 days old. I know about it. But we are meeting in new year. So hearty congratulations to you, and I wish you very happy and prosperous new year. A lot has been said by previous speakers, Gurinder Singh Ji, then Kohli Sahab, and then I have to speak, because Kohli Sahab, as a keynote speaker, he has dealt at length from the day of independence till today, many things he has said. So I will not repeat, but I have to welcome you also. Because I have been introduced very correctly that I am the president, I am presiding over this function. So I have really great pleasure in associating myself with this function of NRI Welfare Society of India. and share my views with you, my friends. As you might be aware, NRI Welfare Society of India was started with noble objective of strengthening the emotional bonds between India and non-resident Indians. The founder secretary general, you have seen on the screen few minutes before about the role late Harbhajan Singh ji has played, but I will be doing a mistake if I will not mention about him here also. The founder secretary general, late Sri Harbhajan Singh ji, has made tremendous contribution, not ordinary contribution, tremendous contribution in the growth of this organization, and is a story of great success as NGO. You can see that. I pay my tribute to him on this occasion. I extend my hearty welcome now to the delegates I have and who have come from various parts of the world. I am also happy to welcome distinguished dignitaries seated on the dais. Here, I would like to say that the Secretary General Gurinder Singh ji, Deepak, they are son of illustrious father, but they are worthy son of illustrious father. You can see the organization they make, and you all are here. The legacy is continuing to help India only. And I will not repeat what has been said already. I will just little bit talk in short. I will not speak extempore, because in extempore we were parliamentarians only, nothing else. So when you start speaking extempore, you see new thoughts starts coming. So I will go in my written text and try to save time for my other friends. First paragraph about the technological advancement with vast technological changes actually, and a number of major developments which have taken place all over the world of today is very different from what I can say 66 years ago when India became independent. Economy is playing more dominant role today, overshadowing the social, political aspects of human lives in the whole world. The globalization of economy has emerged as a very powerful and potent force which one can hardly ignore. We can't ignore now. Even the foreign policy, I tell you, of any country. I am in public life since last more than 6 decades in public life. So I have seen things. Earlier, the political relation was most important. Today, in foreign policy, you have to give the input of economic policy. Otherwise, that becomes most important thing. You can see the president of France has come. And today in newspaper, you must have read so many agreements signed, not only in Delhi, in Chandigarh, you can see. Because economic relation is paramount. Of course, for India, security agreements also is very important, because peace and development go hand in hand. That is there. So economic relation determines now the political relation, cultural relation, all the relationships with the foreign countries. That is the situation today. Let me state by briefly reviewing the state of Indian economy, because Kohli Sahib, my dear friend, has already in keynote address touched all those topics, so I will be very brief and short about that. Let me start by briefly reviewing the state of the Indian economy at present. I will talk only about at present, because past, present, already has said. So I will. Our economy has been rapidly integrating with the global economy over the past decades with a growing sense of self-confidence. Why I use this word self-confidence? Because when this organization, Harbhajan Singh ji, started, actually, do you know what was the situation? When Mr. P.V. Narasimha Rao was the Prime Minister and Dr. Manmohan Singh was the Finance Minister, this liberalization policy picked up. You all know about that. But after that, there was no absolute majority and there were coalition governments, not one-party governments. So a lot of apprehensions were there, and I had the opportunity to to see how much effort this NRI Society of India has done to build up confidence and to convince the NRIs that the in economic policy, in foreign policy, India in fundamentals, that it doesn't change. So the same policy will continue any government, maybe one party government or coalition government. But it will continue, and you have seen it continued. And therefore, the role of the NRI Society of India has been tremendous. And therefore, the society has reached to this stage today. Since we launched economic reforms in 1991, our economy has grown at average rate of 6% per annum. Today also, there is no less of 6%. About China, always it is mentioned in speeches also, China is not democracy. We are transforming our economy through democracy. And you know, you all are very proud wherever you are in the whole world. You are doing so well, and everywhere the whole world has accepted the success of Indian democracy. Nowhere in the world, in such a large population, democracy is flourishing. Nowhere. You cite me any example. In our neighbor, you can see. And Winston Churchill, it was mentioned about me that we are product of freedom struggle. We are born in those days. And of course, Gandhian family, my father himself was a Gandhian. But I will tell you, when you remember, you go to the archives here in India, or those who are in UK, you can see there, Winston Churchill said, when we got independence, that I wish well for the democracy of India, because he was not the Prime Minister, Mr. Attlee was the Prime Minister, Labour Party was in power, then this independence was given. So he said that, but India, it can't succeed, he said that. And he gave three reasons. And if I will tell you in short these three reasons, it will look like very convincing. Because first thing he said, why in India the democracy will not succeed, that for success of democracy, parliamentary democracy, 100% education is a must. That Mr. Churchill said, which was not there. I think Kohli Sahib did not mention about that point, but at length he has said about when we became independent, there were 8% people only educated, only 8%, you can imagine. And there were only 27 universities. So Churchill said, how democracy will succeed in India, where only 8% people are educated? Then he said, culturally also, overwhelming majority should follow one culture, which is not there in India. Variety, so much diversity. Then he said, the Indian people don't speak one language. So for success of parliamentary democracy, one language. That the three criteria he said. At that time, many things are there, but in short, I told you. But you have seen, by the blessing of all of you, and the Indian people has proved that we are today the most successful democracy of the world. There is no democracy anywhere where such a huge population is. There you cite me any example. It's a matter of pride for every Indian and for all of you, I can say. So therefore, through democracy, economic change is also taking place. It is not like China, and moreover, Chinese people in numbers, they are much more in business. You know better than us. And therefore, if you will see their foreign reserve, naturally you will get the higher is there. There is list out about it. But we are also not lagging behind. You see, Kohli Sahib also mentioned about that. What was at the starting time? What was the foreign reserve? And what is today foreign reserve? We are not lagging behind in that. And global situation, you are aware, in spite of that, Indian economy has a very sound foundation and it is stable. And we are in a position to face the challenges. So therefore, I mentioned to you 6% average, if you will take. It was higher in 2008, 2009. There was a decline. But today, if you'll see, average is 6%, not less than this. So this is not an ordinary success. The global financial crisis, however, posed newer set of problems. It was mentioned earlier also. So it is there. But we are still managing well. And there is, in my, so far I understand, nowhere in the world, there is always up and down. But the downward trends also is not affecting as much as it is affecting Europe and including America. In India, it's not affecting, in that much I'm mentioning. Not that we are not affected, we are also affected little bit. But we are still managing and there is a great hope. It has been already mentioned that we have very young population, very talented people we have. Yeah, the younger generation is very talented, not only here, they are going abroad also, they are raising the prestige of our country very, very high. And you all are raising the, you all are ambassadors of the country, I understand. So therefore, India in all this crisis situation also, not doing bad, this I can say. If we are not doing very well, we are not doing bad also. We have to feed, it was mentioned about that, when we became independent, what was the position? Needle was not produced in this country. And today, what we are not producing in this country? What was the total food production? 50 million tons, that's all. Now we are exporting, our basmati rice is so famous abroad. We can't. So every field, I'm not going to repeat what has been already said. So therefore, I'm sure that you know all these things, sir, you are very confident, and your mother, this is our country, is your motherland also, our motherland. And in short, I will tell you, not going in long speech, because I have to see that my other friends also speak. And therefore, I will not repeat that. But Mrs. Gandhi's name was also mentioned. And I was in her cabinet, Mrs. Gandhi's cabinet. And this is the story of 80s. This is the story of 80s. I was with her as a cabinet minister. And at that time, for the first time, astronaut, jisko hum log Hindi mein kehte hain, antriksh yatri, for the first time, astronaut had gone to the space. And in any government, parliamentary ministers are always around prime ministers, even today. They are always around prime ministers. So I had parliamentary affairs portfolio also. So a scientist came, met Mrs. Gandhi in the office, and I was there also, sitting with madam, talking about the deliberation which was going in the house. So then Mrs. Gandhi told me that they have come, so let us listen to them, what they want to make some request. Then they made request to Mrs. Gandhi, madam, in Vayu Bhavan, the place called Vayu Bhavan, just near Parliament, we have installed instruments, so it is a historic moment, and our astronaut is in the space. So please kindly come and talk to the astronauts. Mrs. Gandhi told me also that Bhishma Narayan ji always, she was telling me, Bhishma Narayan ji, aap bhi aa jaiye. So we had gone there. It's in short, I'm telling you. And then we had gone there. The sitting arrangement was there. We sat. Then Mrs. Gandhi told the top scientist who was there that please connect the astronaut. The moment he connected, Mrs. Gandhi asked the astronauts, you might be knowing his name. Mrs. Gandhi asked, aap ye batao ki, his name was Rakesh Sharma. Rakesh, ye batao कि तुमको अंतरिक्ष से भारतवर्ष कैसा दिखाई पड़ता है? तो राकेश ने कहा, मैडम, सारे जहां से अच्छा हिंदुस्तान हमारा, सारे जहां से अच्छा हिंदुस्तान हमारा, सारे जहां से अच्छा हिंदुस्तान हमारा. तो वी बिलोंग टू दैट करंट कंट्री. देयर इज नो नीड ऑफ बिकमिंग पेसिमिस्ट एट ऑल. वी आर ऑल ऑप्टिमिस्ट पीपल. एट द टाइम ऑफ फ्रीडम स्ट्रगल, डू यू नो व्हाट पीपल वर सेइंग? गुरेंद्र जी मेंशनड अबाउट sunset doesn't take, because Indians are everywhere, where sunset doesn't take place. See, Gurinder ji mentioned his speech. I listen everybody's speech very, very, very carefully. But I tell you, he mentioned about that. So therefore, when we freedom struggle was going on in the villages, people were saying, impossible to get freedom, because what Gandhi is talking, through the weapon of truth and non-violence, he is going to fight injustice, he is going to fight Britishers. But this is also unique case in the whole world. Nowhere any country has secured independence, got independence through weapon of truth and non-violence. There also Gandhi has shown the path to the whole world. So that's India. He's our father of the nation. So therefore, nothing to be pessimistic about the future of this country. The future of the country is very bright, and the future of the country is bright not because of all of us who are here, because of all of you. I can say we will definitely, you are participating, you are investing. I know in many places NRIs are investing in this country. No time to mention those things. So therefore, I will not take much time. I have long many things, but repetition, I don't like to do that. So with these words, I thank you very much for giving patient hearing, and wish you all the best, and I wish a very fruitful deliberation. Thank you very much.
Indeed, sir, for that wonderful inaugural address. Ladies and gentlemen, that was our Honourable Chief Guest, Dr. Bhishma Rayan Singh. And before I invite our next eminent speaker, a distinguished dignitary on the dais for the address, I would like to inform all our delegates present here that after this address, we shall have the open house session. And for that, I would request all our delegates to kindly hand over the names in case you are interested in addressing with your details to our support staff present here. They are around the hall in uniform saris. May I request our staff to kindly identify themselves? Please raise your hands. You can hand over your names with all your details to them, and we'll be inviting you. So our next eminent speaker, Sri Dalbir Singh, has been the National Security of Indian National Conference, has handled challenging assignments of the Northeast besides strategic policy and planning, logistics, organizational work in coordination of election campaign and national political programs of the party. He is the Senior Advisor, Forum of Federations, Canada, President for Policy and Governance, Advisor to Board of Girl Rising India and SPICMICE, besides being chairman of Standing Conference, One Globe Uniting Knowledge Communities. He has been chairman of Shaheed Bhagat Singh College and on the governing board of Universal Business School. He was mayor for Commonwealth Games 2010 and is currently the national vice president of National Tennis Federation. He was elected president of Global Coalition Against TB with support of Bill Gates Foundation and Global Health Strategies. He has presented number of papers globally on subjects like governance, democracy, federalism, and governor for a by the Russian presidents. Those were saying for his address.
Honorable Jugan Gurinder Singh at this conference invited to speak a time that I had an op that there speak towards the end. Luminaries speak. Words, you fellows, three learning figure, I got DPF in this country. India's $9 billion, which is only that we have buys something close to 280,000 crores. Our dollar bills have come down now because the oil prices have crashed in the last couple of years. But apart from that, it has helped us to get foreign exchange reserves, to tide us our debt and a whole lot of other problems. You fellows have also brought best practices to India. Some of our finest NRIs were Mahatma Gandhi, Netaji Bose, Sardar Patel, Jawaharlal Nehru, and of course, later on, whole range of people from Sam